This is TWiT.
And we've heard of many new applications for satellite. We've heard about the low orbit satellite internet. It seems that there's been a sparked interest in satellite internet from the hacking community as well. And I'm just curious exactly what HackSat is including. Curtis, take it away.
Well, thank you. We talked about DefCon earlier, and last year, 2019 DefCon, there was a great announcement at a new village. If you're not aware, DefCon has special interests that are organized in what are called villages. Well, last year, one came about that was aerospace. It had some significant involvement by the Air Force, and they promised that this year there was going to be a competition to see who could hack a satellite. Everyone was going to get around, watch, see this great thing. And then 2020 happened. But that didn't stop the competition. This spring, over 2,000 teams went through the preliminaries to try to be qualified to get into the finals at DefCon. Eight teams succeeded. The eight teams were from around the world, and they were presented with a series of challenges. If you're familiar at all with a capture the flag competition that is common in the security world, there were aspects of that in the whole competition to hack a sat. Now, this one had some physical angles to it because every team had a real practice satellite, something called a flat sat, that they tried to work on. And the flat sats were sitting on air bearings, so they would spin. They were orbiting around the lab, and the wireless access points that communicated with them were also moving to try and get some of the real angles of space-based communications into the competition. Well, the five different challenges included things like going in and trying to regain control of a ground communication station that had been taken over by an adversary. The same adversary had corrupted the code on a satellite, which was now tumbling out of control. So after gaining access to the ground station, the teams had to reestablish communications with the satellite, regain control of the satellite, then regain control of the satellite's payload. The final proof that they had done that was taking an image of a model moon sitting in the lab. And here's one of the cool things. The Air Force made available a tantalizing prospect that one of the teams, the one that did the solution deemed to be the best, would have their solution uploaded to an actual satellite to see if they could reorient the satellite, which normally points to the Earth, and grab an image of the real moon. Well, over the course of 2 days, there was a ton of activity as teams went back and forth, gaining and losing points, surging into the lead, falling back. But by the end of the weekend, there was a clear winner in points. Unfortunately, the clear winner in points couldn't win. Why? Because they had timed out on the solution to take an image of the moon. There was a winning team. First runner-up, second runner-up, and then there was the team that was able to have their solution uploaded to the actual satellite. Now, they actually were able to grab an image of the moon with their solution. So huge bragging rights to a team called Poland Can Into Space. The other teams, the team that came in first, second, and third, well, they had to settle for cash. And in this case, the top prize was $50,000 to be split among the team members. A team called PFS did that. It was wonderful to see this, and it was very interesting to hear a couple of things from Will Roper, who is Assistant Secretary for Acquisition Technology and Logistics for the U.S. Air Force, and Brett Goldstein, who's Director of the Defense Digital Service. They presented the awards, and they talked about how good it was to see the creativity, how useful it was to have more individuals interested in security of space-based assets. And in one of those really interesting sort of admissions, Dr. Roper said, you know, this is something we should have been involved with a long, long time ago. Well, it's absolutely certain that they're going to be running Hackasat again next year. And I'm told that the team that organized the competition is giving themselves about 3 weeks off before they start planning next year's operation. Well, I want to talk about this with my co-hosts. And Mo, I'm going to come to you first. What do you think about the idea of using competitions or contests for professionals to improve and demonstrate their technical capabilities?
Well, and I've participated in a couple of CTFs, and they're a lot of fun. I think that there's a lot of criticism, probably justifiably, that CTFs don't demonstrate real world expertise. Although I got to tell you, this one certainly sounds far and above anything that I could have even begun to attempt. But there's a, I think the real value is, especially as we try to get more people involved in InfoSec and certainly more diversity, that if we could get a the gamification part of it is probably where the real value is, because people don't know what they don't know, but it's a great way to get them interested and involved in things. In fact, I can tell you that I probably would have never started my first CTF or done my first CTF except for that there was a gamification about it, and it was for Trace Labs, and Trace Labs does CTFs for OSINT, so open source intelligence, and they do it in a way to help law enforcement search for missing people. And so that was just basically my first introduction into it. And I think that's a really, that those kinds of things are a really good way to interest people who don't know what CTFs are about, don't really know necessarily all the skills that are involved. And it's a great way to sucker them in and get them hooked on the InfoSec bug.
Well, you know, getting people hooked on InfoSec is a good thing, especially considering just how huge the skills gap is between the number of professionals we have and the number of professionals we need. Lou, I'm curious about your take on something. You know, this had sponsorship by the Air Force, as well as Space Force, DOD, and a bunch of others. What do you think about the idea of large government organizations or even large enterprises sponsoring and participating in competitions like this?
I think it's interesting. I think it sends an interesting message because, you know, a lot of large enterprises do bug bounties and have these kind of competitions only to, you know, improve their technology, their products. And when you have government agencies do it, you kind of have to wonder, why are they doing that? Unless they really don't know the vulnerabilities they have and if it's even possible. And they just wanted to prove it in a more benign way. And so that's kind of why I was wondering exactly why the Department of Defense, the Air Force, and everyone was involved in this one, maybe to prove a point that there needs to be some more, space-based cybersecurity coverage along the way, especially on government satellites. And so maybe they just wanted to kind of more proof in the pudding. But I think it's very interesting that they're doing it. And again, they could actually recruit from this process as well, which is, I thought that was interesting. So, you know, I think only time will tell to see what they actually do with all of the knowledge they get and even some of the resources.
Well, we do know that from other Capture the Flag operations that there are cybersecurity organizations that use them as recruiting opportunities. And there are many cybersecurity professionals who use them as part of their credentials. So it's going to be fascinating to see what happens to this as it moves forward. Can hardly wait to see the kind of hack-a-set competition they come up with for 2021.